كيف فعل. Here referring to Allah, ألم يجعل that, ألم يفعل. Different verb is being used. What's the benefit here? Ja'ala is to take something that already exists and transform it. What the word itself indicates is Allah let them have their plan, let them finish the entire execution of it, plan it out for months and months, get secure the funds, secure the army, secure the training, secure the means for the journey, let them run it the whole way and put it to waste at the very end. He transformed, he morphed the plan at the very end. In other words, he didn't deviate the plan in the beginning. He could have not allowed them to consume an army, or to amass an army, or to come up with the funds, or to be able to make it all the way. You know, they could have never met Abu Rigal. Remember the navigator that got them all the way to Mecca? They could have never met him if Allah had wanted. But he let them think the plan is in order. But he took that plan and made it different at the very end. So that's what Ja'ala seems to indicate, is that this is Alam Yaj'al, that Allah Azza wa Jal let them played them along, basically played them, and at the end Allah Azza wa Jal pulled the strings on them. By the way, this, I don't know if I've given you this parallel before, but it's an interesting parallel. My teacher Dr. Sami used to give it to me. He says when someone's rebellious, one of the things Allah does is he lets them go free, and they feel like they got no problems, they can get away with anything. And it's compared to a dog that is wild. It's barking at you, it's biting at you. So you tie it up, right? And you tie it up with a 1 foot leash. So it can't really move much. But if you really want to punish this dog, you take it in an open field and tie it to a 400 foot leash. Because if you tie it to a 400 foot leash, you know what's going to happen? It's going to think that it's free and it's running full speed. Right? When it's only a foot long leash, it can only pull so much. When it's running full speed and it reaches 400 feet, what happens? You see, it gets yanked, it gets choked, and that pain is far worse than the 1 foot leash. The dog thinks he's got freedom, but this is actually worse for him. وَيَمُدُّهُمْ فِي طُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ Allah extends them in their rebellion. Let them remain blind in it. So Allah extended their means all the way to get to the Kaaba. Allah could have destroyed them much before, but He let them execute their plan. Let them play along. Let them dig their hole deeper. This will only make their punishment worse. Not only are they mushrikun, but they're committing crimes against Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay, now the words arsala, and you know when we get to them, I'll skip this part, so I'll just tell you now. وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ is very particular punishment given to these people. So the past tense is used, which does not include continuity, which there is no need for, because that particular punishment is not repeated by Allah Azza wa Jalla. It was specifically sent to them. And the proof of that specific sending, inshallah, when we get to that ayah. Now, Qaid, another really interesting comment, and this is where you'll see the benefit of that discussion we had before. The word Qaid in Arabic is used similar to the word Makr. So there are two words for making a plan, plot. Really not a plan, a plot. Qaid and Makr. Qaid is used for a plan made in secret. So it's the thing highlighted in a plot. And by the way, by plot, I mean a plan made to harm someone. That's what Qaid basically is, a plan made to harm someone. So you know, military plans can be called qaid. But city planning cannot be called qaid. You understand? When a plan is made like for a military offense or to rob someone, ambush, things like that, that would be qaid if it is made in secret. Now if a plan is made to deceive someone, or deception is being used as part of the plan, right? Deception in planning, that's makr. So when people are being misled, that's makr. When things are being kept secret, that is qaid. These are the two kinds of plots that are linguistically mentioned. Now Allah mentions qaid. Alam yaj'al? كَيْدَهُمْ Didn't he take their plot, implying the plot was secretive, and put it to waste? Now I haven't explained that put it to waste part, but just this plot part. Let's see the question. اِعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْكَيْدْ هُوَ إِرَادَةٌ مُضِرَّةٌ بِالْغَيْبِ عَلَى الْخُفْيَةِ Know that kaid is a word used for an intent made to harm someone, harm the other, and it's made secretly. إِنْ قِيلَ And if you were to ask, فَلِمَ سَمَّاهُ كَيْدًا وَأَمْرُهُ كَانَ ظَاهِرًا How come it's called Qaid while his plan was very open? I mean, he didn't come by night. He came openly with his army, so why call it a secret plan? Well, Qaid iradat wuqu'i al-idrar bil-ghayr fi khufya. Another commentary, same exact thing. وَسُمِّيَ سُبْحَانَهُ مَا فَعَلَهُ أَبْرَهَا وَجَيْشَيْشَهُ قَيْدًا مَعَ أَنَّهُمْ جَاءُوا لِهَدَمِ الْكَعْبَةِ جِهَارًا نَهَارًا They came, even though they came in the midst of the day, and they came without any secrecy. So how can we understand this word in this ayah? لِأَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يُضْمِرُونَ مِنَ الْحَقَدْ وَالْحَسَدْ وَالْعَدَاوَةِ لِأَهْلِ مَكَّةِ One explanation, this is the explanation repeated. Every mufassir that I read that asked this question had pretty much the same answer, which has been because they were hiding in their hearts an animosity against the Meccans that was even worse than the one they were showing. So that's, they're saying that part of it was secret. I personally wasn't very satisfied with that response, because it seems to me that a historical analysis of the events yields a much more powerful response to this question. Now, it may be true, you know, وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُهُمْ أَكْبَرُ. Allah mentions this attitude of kuffar. What they're hiding in their hearts is even worse. That may be true and that may be secret. But, you know, in a society that is that revolves around religion, in a society that revolves around religion, and of course in modern times, mostly nations are trying to push themselves as a secular state. So religion is not the central force in the Christian world or in the Muslim world. It's not the central force. But in the ancient world, religion played a central role in every society, be it pagan, Hindu, Christian, Jewish, Muslim. Religion plays a central role. Now, if religion plays, it is your constitution, it is what you have your allegiance to. When you say you're proud to be, you don't mention nation, you mention religion, right? That was the world view of the past, the pre-modern era. And in that time, if you want to galvanize the people and motivate the people to take military action, what do you use to justify your actions? You use religion. You know, in modern times, you can use patriotism. You can use for the sake of our nation, for the sake of our people, for the sake of our land. By the way, is religion even today used to extend military means and manipulate people? Sure. All religions, by the way. It's not just, you know, one or the other. It's all religions. Use religion as a means of oppression against another. It's possible. It does happen. Now, when we study the historical account, we learn that the motivations were actually not religious. What were they? They were political. They were economic. The Yemen was no longer the economic capital. That had shifted to Mecca. And to get their attention back and to get that revival going, of the trade power going, they had to now make an offense against Mecca. But they covered it up with what facade? With religion. This is our new Kaaba, this is Qulais, they don't come and worship this, they're not Christian people, so they're going to come with the salib, they're going to come with the crucifix, and they're going to make it look like this is a war of religions, the war of faiths. And we're standing up for the religion, and they're galvanizing their people for this cause. Of course, no, Habasha was a very strong Christian state. For them to offer elephants or anything else as military support already suggests they saw it as a Christian thing to justify to their people. But what's hiding underneath, what's the real qaid, is really something else. They have monetary advances. By the way, this qaid is interesting to mention, because this is the same problem with the Quraysh. On the outside, they're saying, أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا. He took all of our gods and made them into one. إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ عُجَابٌ. This is a very, very strange thing. We don't get it. How can all those gods be turned into one? That's on the outside. But you know what's going on the inside? Their entire economy. Their entire economy. I'll give you a comparison. What if you said, some movement comes out in Las Vegas and said, we need to get rid of all the casinos. Right? We need to get rid of all the casinos. And somebody says, no, this is part of our history, it's part of our heritage, it's part of our culture. Is that the real reason that people would be against? It's the money. It's the people that are coming in. Right? So you can cover it up with heritage and history and this and that or the other, but the underlying causes are still there. And this is really exactly what the Quraysh were doing. You get rid of the idols, they have no political power, because all the idols are being held hostage in Mecca. So people have to come and do Hajj. And when they have to come and do Hajj there, they have to go shopping. And when they have to go shopping, their economy booms. That's how it works. And they can go outside and travel without fear. Why? Because the other pagans respect them as custodians of the house where their idols are being held hostage. You get rid of this system, their entire economy collapses. That entire mafia system is finished. So the word qaid is alluding to the qaid of Abraha and the undertones of economic pursuit. But also it's referring to kind of a poke at and a pun at even the Quraysh and the qaid that they made against the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah says, if I can take their qaid, which was much bigger, and he could put that to waste, what is your qaid going to be? Because those who you couldn't fight against, you had to run up into the mountains, those are the ones I put to waste, what are you going to do? Where do you stand? Right? So there's this comparison taking place remarkably in this surah. So, that's just the use of the word qaid. Now let's talk about ضَلَّلَ يُضَلِّلُ تَضْلِيل. Usually in the Qur'an, ضَال is used, ضَلَّ. But this is ضَلَّلَ تَضْلِيل. It's the مصدر of التفعيل, باب التفعيل. So let's understand the difference between them. ضَلَّ to be lost, literally, to lose, to be lost. to place something where you can no longer find it, etc. ضلل, to waste, to destroy. أي ضيعه, to put it completely to waste, where it's no longer usable at all. ألم يجعل, this is the tafsir commentary, ألم يجعل سعي الحبشة أصحاب الفيل في تخريب الكعبة في تضليل, يعني didn't we take the efforts of the Habasha, the people of the elephant, in the destruction of the Kaaba? Didn't we put it into waste? Meaning, في تضليلهم عما أرادوا وحاولوا من تخريبها, in wasting their plans in regards to the efforts they made in destroying it. This is the base meaning. But then they go a step further. The word تضليل in Arabic, تفعيل generally, has repetition in it. In other words, Allah at many occasions put it to waste. The first time they built the Qullays, they thought, who's going to compare with this super mall that we've built of a Kaaba compared to that old rinkety place over there in Mecca? Who's going to go there now that we have this? That failed. Then they tried to convince people to turn in this direction. That failed. Then another failure was burnt. It was burnt down. We learned about that. And it was defecated upon, etc. So that's another tadleel. Then they came all the way here to destroy the Kaaba, and that went into failure. So if anything, it added to the awe and respect for the Kaaba rather than reducing it. It only, put their entire plan to waste. So one after another, their plans were destroyed. وَمَا دُعَاءُ الْكَافِرِينَ إِلَّا فِي ضَلَالٍ, like Allah says, what is the prayer of disbelievers except being put to waste? Now, a little bit more commentary, inshallah ta'ala. The word fi, the use of the word fi, this is also very important. وَمَعْنَا حَرْفَ الظَّرْفِ, when the Mufassir says حَرْفَ الظَّرْفَ شَوْكَانِ, he's referring to the word fi. Allah didn't say he put their plan to waste. He said he put their plan in utter waste. Now what's the benefit of saying in? In Arabic, in is used to give you imagery. That's why he calls it حَرْفَ الظَّرْفِ. ظَرْف literally means a location, a space, a time, right? So it's either ظَرْف زَمَان or مَكَان, time or space. In this case, he's almost making you visualize, it is as though you take something good and you throw it in a fire where it's burned to a crisp and it's useless. It can't be used anymore. So Allah took their entire elaborate plan, which was so well made, and He completely put it to waste. And that waste is clear for everyone to see. So that element of being able to see, كَانَ قَدْ ظَهْرٌ لِكُلِّ عَاقِلٍ, it could be easy for anyone to see how that elaborate plan was completely destroyed and wasted. ضَلَّلَ, actually, one more linguistic comment on it. Imr al-Qais was also called this al-Malik al-Dalil. Dalil with Dad, not Dal, that's the other word, okay? Al-Dalil. Imr al-Qais was called the king with the quality of Dalil. Why? لِأَنَّهُ ضَلَّلَ مُلْكَ أَبِيهِ أَيْ ضَيَّعَهُ, because he wasted the fortunes of his father. He inherited kingdom, and he wasted the fortunes of his father. So his name became Dalil, because he put it to complete waste. He could have done so much with it, but he wasted the whole thing. Now we get to the last two ayat, inshallah ta'ala, or three ayat. Maybe I'll go 10 more minutes, inshallah ta'ala, and we'll conclude next week, and combine Suratul Fil with it. Let's see. Let me at least finish this third ayah, and then we'll conclude. وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيِّرًا أَبَابِيلٍ, and he sent against them birds, that's I'm again literal translation right now, he sent against them birds, ababil, herds upon herds upon herds. Now, just a historical comment describing the birds. When Abdul Muttalib turns back, فَالْتَفَتَ, he turned away, وَهُوَ يَدْعُوا, and he was making dua to Allah, فَإِذَا هُوَ بِطَيْرٍ, then all of a sudden he sees birds, مِنْ نَحْوِ الْيَمَنِ, coming from the direction of Yemen, which is interesting because the army also came from Yemen, right? وَاللَّهُ, وَاللَّهِ, he says, فقال, he says, I swear by Allah, إِنَّهَا لَطَيْرٌ غَرِيبَةٌ, it is very strange kinds of birds for sure. مَا هِيَ بِنَجْدِيَّ وَلَا تَهَمِيَّ, they're not from Najd and they're not from Tahama. كَانَ مَعَ كُلِّ طَائِرٍ حِجْرٍ فِي مِنْقَارِهِ وَحِجْرًا فِي رِجْلَيْهِ, and in every single bird there would be a pebble in its beak and two pebbles in each of its claws, in its feet. Okay, so that's his description of it. فَكَانَ الْحِجْرُ يَقَعُ عَلَى رَأْسِ الرَّجُلِ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْ دُبْرِهِ, then the stone that they would land, these rocks, these pebbles that would land, they would land on the head of a person and come out from behind them. قَالَ أَبُو عُبَيْدَ أَبَابِيل, Abu Ubaidah describing the word أَبَابِيل says, جَمَعَاتْ فِي تَفَرُّقَ, multiple groups of different kinds. In other words, it wasn't one species of bird, there were many different species of birds. And that will come more later on also. يقال جاءت الخيل أبابيل, it is also said the horses came herds upon herds from many different directions. أي جماعات من هاهنا وهاهنا, groups upon groups coming from here and there. قال النحاس, نحاس a great grammarian of our history, wrote إعراب القرآن, وحقيقته أنها جماعات عظام, and the reality is that these are huge groups. huge, awesome flocks of birds. Not one, but many different flocks of birds. I haven't seen too many birds in Texas. But you know, if you travel between like New York and Maryland, sometimes birds are migrating, especially in the area of Delaware, a lot of birds, right? So you'll see for a good half hour, just a flock of tens of hundreds of thousands of birds, a continuous stream. And according to other historical narrations, they were coming from every direction, and you couldn't see the sky, it became dark. SubhanAllah. It's an incredible scene to even imagine. And so, you know, when we read this language and I'm translating, you can imagine the Arabs, because they have such picturesque imagery in their language. When this story was told over and over and over again, you can imagine children sitting around and imagining this, as though they can almost see it. And you have to know that the Arabs had an amazing imagination. They really did. They were in the desert. There's nothing really to look at. So when you're in that kind of situation, you develop an active imagination, which shows in their literature. Their literature is full of picturesque imagery. And it kind of compensates for the lack of imagery in reality in the terrain of Arabia, you know? Anyhow. So, وَقِيلْ كَانَتْ طَيْرًا خَضْرًا خَرَجَتْ مِنَ الْبَحْرِ. And it said that these were green birds that came out of the ocean. So you have varying narrations historically about the kinds of birds. But, you see, what happens sometimes in tafsir, this is my personal comment, you don't have to agree with it, okay? What happens in tafsir sometimes is, our mufassirun, may Allah reward all of them, they get so busy talking about what, sometimes you lose sight of how. Allah didn't pay it, He doesn't want us to pay attention to what species of birds, and how long their beaks were, and what color were they. What's this great information? Alhamdulillah, we have it. What's the point? Allah didn't say what He did, Allah said, how? How? How can that be? How can small creatures like birds, that are weightless, that are literally weightless, destroy an army associated with the most monumental weights? Elephants. How can that be? How can you take these most two extreme things? You know, a lot of times you'll see if you go to the zoo, there are elephants and there's birds sitting on top of them. Harmless creature to the elephant. The creature they would never expect any harm from, right? And then how can that be that Allah uses birds, herds upon herds of them, to destroy this monumental army, subhanAllah. Now the use of the word arsala ala, arsala alayhim, as opposed to arsala ila. Ala tufidu al-isti'la. The word ala, it serves the benefit of showing superiority or being above. وَإِسْتِعْمَالَ عَلَى فِي الْقُرْآنِ عَجِيبٌ. And it's a unique usage in the Qur'an. فِيهِ اسْتِعْلَاءُ وَتَسَلُّطُ. And it includes that of domination and of, you know, wreaking havoc upon someone and imposing oneself, forcing upon oneself. وَلِذَلِكَ الْعَذَابُ يَأْتِي بِعَلَى. And that is why in the Qur'an, when we find Allah sending punishment, He doesn't say أَرْسَلَ, He sent to, He said He sent upon, عَلَى. Which illustrates punishment. Like He sent a rain upon them, or destruction upon them, etc. So to and upon, in English they seem kind of ambiguous, but in Arabic it makes a big difference between ala and ila. So ala, hatta idha fatahna alayhim baban dha adhabin shadeed, ala, until we open the doors against them, upon them, over them, that had punishment of intense value. Wa arsala alayhim tayran, fa arsala alayhim al-tufan. So we find over and over again, we send birds against them, a storm against them. When against is used, ala is used. But when a messenger is sent, a messenger is not punishment, a messenger is mercy. فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنَ رَسُولًا. Not ala fir'auna, but ila fir'auna. Illustrating that even though he was sent to Fir'aun, he was still a mercy. If he was sent as a punishment, what word would have been used? Ala, right? So it would have been a different word altogether. So ala comes ma'al uqubat, with punishments. So now some commentary on the birds, and then inshallah ta'ala we finish our session for today. وَقَوْلُ تَعَالَى ذِكْرُهُ وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ رَبُّكَ طَيْرًا مُتَفَرِّقًا. This is Tabari's commentary, by the way. He sent upon, your master sent upon them birds that were of different nature. يَتْبَعُ بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا مِنْ نَوَاحٍ شَتَّى. And one group would follow another from different directions. وَهِيَ جَمَعْ لَا وَاحِدَ لَهَا. And ababil, the word ababil is a plural word for which there is no singular in Arabic. Ababil means herds upon herds, groups upon groups, right? Flocks upon flocks in bird terminology. I wouldn't say herds for birds, but you know, flocks upon flocks of birds. Scores upon scores, if you will, right? وَالطَّيِّرْ اسم جمع لكل ما من شأنه أن يطير في الهواء. And طَيِّرْ, the word طَيِّرْ is used as a plural noun, a collective noun it's called in English, signifying all birds. So he didn't say طُيُّرْ, he said طَيِّرْ, which means just all forms of birds. If we just say طُيُّرْ, birds, but if you say طَيِّرْ, all kinds of birds, they came. والتنكيره للتنويع والتهويل. And making the تنوين on it طيّراً. You hear that تنوين on it. The benefit of that is that تنويع, illustrating there were many different kinds, والتهويل and to terrify. Because تنوين is used in Arabic for a ذم or إغراء even. Birds were sent. And it, you know, I'm pounding on it like that because that's what the Nasab state does in Arabic sometimes. And so why is that important to note? Because the Arabs who remember that, they're being told, remember the birds? You know, that's how they're being told. Because this is not something that's some ancient event that they never knew about. This is something they know about. And you, that doesn't scare you that those birds didn't drop pebbles on you, right? They had GPS on you too, but you know, they only dropped it on other targets. So this is للتهويل, to terrify them. So almost done, inshallah ta'ala. Ababil, we talked about herds upon herds. Similar plurals in Arabic are shamatit, abadid, wa nahwa dhalik. So just a little bit more about Ababil, for those of you that are Arabic students. Ibn Hisham says, Al-Ababil, al-jama'at, wa lam tatakallam al-arab, biwahid. That the Arabs never used a singular word for Ababil. Ibn Abbas wa al-Dahak, both of them say, Ababil yatba'u ba'duhum ba'dan. That Ababil refers to groups that follow one after the other. Hassan al-Basri and Qatada say, Al-Ababil al-Kathira. Ababil refers to that which are many and many. وقال مجاهد أبابيل شتى متتابعة مجتمعة. That they are dispersed, that they are continuous, and they are unified in one place. So they're dispersed in terms of their تنوير, their nature, different species of birds, but they're grouped together, bunched together. And they come from المختلفة تأتي من هاهنا ومن هاهنا. That they are different kinds of birds. This is what Ibn Zayd says. They come from here and from there. أتتهم من كل مكان. And it came upon them from every single direction. وقال الفراء, once again, لم أسمع من العربي في توحيدها شيئا. I didn't hear from the Arabs using a singular form of it ever. That's just وأرسل عليهم طيرا أبابيل. I'm going to give you a little view of inshallah ta'ala what we're going to be doing next week, finishing this surah and moving on to surah Quraysh. But I want to just mention this one thing. This surah is a gift to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and in and of itself, you know, Al-Biqa'i rahimahullah, commenting on this surah, he said that Allah's Messenger, Allah Azza wa Jal, gives his Messenger gifts even before he's born. And he protects his city, and the city in which he's going to be born, you know, and the house, and that house which he wasn't even praying in the direction of to begin with. But Allah knew that eventually he will be praying in that direction, and he turns back towards the Qibla, tardaha, to please that Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we have this newly found respect and honor and regard for the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because of just the phrase, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ. Just that word, رَبُّكَ, gives us newly found respect and a refreshed appreciation of how highly Allah regards his Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was an event, the Makkan Salat, this was done for them. They thought Allah protected them. And Allah made it clear, no, this is for you. This is for you, number one, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, subhanallah. So may Allah Azza wa Jal give us a clear and a deep understanding of this book and the ability to practice upon it. May Allah Azza wa Jal take the good things that are said and enter it into our hearts. And anything that is incorrect, may He remove it from our memories and our hearts. Barakallahu li wa lakum fi al-Qur'an al-Hakim. Wa nafa'ni wa iyaakum bil-ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.